Church.
Good evening, Pastor.
And welcome to our midweek Bible study.
Yes.
And we're going to continue the course that we've been on. And we are, you know, we're making our way through the Pauline epistles, and we're in chapter 6 of Ephesians. We're going to start chapter 6 tonight and sort of just pick up right where we left off. Let's pray. And I know that we have some folks that's not feeling well tonight, and you know, we want to just continue to remember them, and we want to remember you also if you're not feeling well, and even you may be feeling great.
That's right.
But we just want to thank God for giving us another day, another opportunity. Father, we thank you.
Thank
we
you,
praise Father. You, Lord, because you are El Shaddai. You are the all-sufficient one. You are the great I am.
Yes.
And God, you made it possible that we could call upon you any time of the day or night.
That's right.
And you said that it's wonderful that when we do, I think that you are well pleased when we cry out to you, Lord, because it identifies that we need you. And we thank you, Lord, for being there.
Yes.
And Lord, tonight as we look into your word, I pray, God, that you speak to us boldly. And God, that in your word, that we would be encouraged and strengthened, that we can leave knowing more than what we knew when we came in tonight, that, Lord, that we would be touched by the presence of your Holy Spirit, God, and Lord, that you will lift us up higher
yes.
than what we were when we came in.
Yes.
Lord, I pray for those who are not feeling well tonight, God, that you would give them a dose of encouragement, Lord, touch them in a special way.
That's right.
Allow them to experience the grace of God, that peace that surpasses all understanding.
Yes.
God, we're going to continue to pray for Pastor Davis as
yes.
he has returned home, but you know, just catching up on things at home now. And I pray, God, that you give him the strength and the resolve to just see this week through, that when the week ends, that he'll be able to get some rest and relax his mind, Father. Give him also that peace, Lord, that can only come from you. And we thank you, Lord, that
you
continue to watch over us and care for us in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know, we ended chapter 5 by and we look at the later part of chapter 5, I think picking up somewhere around verse 22. It's Paul started talking about wives, and we're not going to go back over this, but he's getting into wives, he's talking about order, and basically talking about how they need to be subject or submitted to their own husbands. And then he talked about the husbands and how husbands need to learn how to love their wives, you know. So, and the thing that I want to point out here is that he really emphasized husbands loving their wives. He emphasized wives respecting their husbands. And I think that goes a long way. And there's a lot said has to be said about that. And so Paul didn't stop there. So when we look, as we move on and we go into chapter 6, now he's talking about children. And let's look at what he has to say about this. It says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Verse 2, honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise." and then it goes on to say, verse 3, "that it may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth." Now, it's something about that. You know, so he's saying that children, obey your parents. And it's something about raising up a child to where they learn how to obey. And you don't have to teach a person, a child, how to be bad. You know, it's almost like the bad part comes naturally. But you have to work at trying to instill some good behavior in a young person.
That's right.
And then on a young person, they're very, and they say the ages of 1 through 5 or 1 through 6
mm-hmm.
are the most pliable ages, that you can instill some good qualities in them and some good virtues and set them on a right course.
That's right.
And not only that, but teaching them at a young age to be responsible,
and
or the responsibility of learning how to obey,
and
how to follow orders, or how to follow commands, or how to follow directions. And I don't know if you remember, you know, some of the children, I know I had 3 of them,
mm-hmm.
and they got to a point where they used to ask why.
Yeah.
You know, you tell them to do something and they want to know why. And some parents may get a little frustrated when the child asks them, "Well, why I do it because I told you to do it." Maybe it might be the response, or like my mother said, "I'm the mother here, so let's go ahead and do it."
Yeah.
And but the kids, they begin to formulate things in their own head, and they want to understand why they're doing certain things.
That's right. And I hate to interrupt you,
no, go ahead.
But because I say so is not an answer. What you're depriving that child of at that particular time is a learning moment.
Yeah.
A teaching moment for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know you feel superior. We feel superior because that's a child asking why.
Yeah.
You giving an order. But explain to that child
right.
so they'll know.
Right.
And the next time they won't ask that question
right.
why.
Right.
A learning and teaching moment.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
And I always, I heard a person that was mentoring me that said, "And even if they ask a question that you know that they're not going to understand,
still,
the response,
still,
give them
time.
Something." Yeah.
Right.
And it helps them out. So it's
mm-hmm.
teaching them how to be the responsibility of learning how to be obedient.
That's right.
And so we say, well, should we question God? I mean, because God gives us direction and but God says, "Come, let us reason together."
Together.
And I think that God wants us to understand, to the best of our ability, to understand why we're doing what we're doing.
Mm.
He doesn't just want us to follow Him blindly. Matter of fact, that's the reason why we, in some cases, we have choices.
Yeah.
You know, and we're. He made us free mortal agents so that we can have those choices. Even though He knows the outcome, but still gives us an opportunity to make a decision or to choose.
Right.
And so, so one of the most important things as a parent is is how we raise up our children.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what we are instilling and what we are conveying to our children. That's very important. And like I said, we don't have to teach a child the negative aspects, because that's that's inherent.
That's automatic.
You know, they're gonna do what they're gonna do.
That's automatic.
Regardless. And so, but it's essential that a parent teach a child how to be obedient. You know, that's the essential part. Teaching a child how to be obedient, and also teaching them, helping them to understand about knowing who God is, or knowing God and understanding a relationship of why we do things in the sight of God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we can't leave God out of the picture. When you're training up a child, you can't leave God out of the picture. You need to include God in your training.
That's right.
And so we look at what's going on today in society, and they say that our moral system is broken, and it goes back to the home.
Mm-hmm.
It goes back to what are the children being exposed to in
at home.
Home.
That's right.
And you know, you just amaze me that you can some. And I want to pick on music for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
And some of these, I've seen 1-2-year-old kids can repeat songs, and they know what the words are in the song.
Word for word.
And I'm thinking they don't know anything about the Bible.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so we know if they can learn words to a song,
yeah,
you can teach them, and they can learn things about the Bible. So we know that children are learnable, or they're teachable.
That's
so
right.
It's our responsibility as parents to give them this foundation. And that's really what it is. It's giving them a foundation of something that they can build on, and something that will be with them forever. So parents are not to discourage their children by being harsh and unreasonable. And I say that because a lot of times, we take things out on our children.
Well,
but we expect more out of our children than I think we expect out of ourselves.
Yeah.
Because think about how long it took you to get something right.
That's right.
But we expect our child to get it right the first time.
But and that goes back. If you don't teach a child, how you expecting them to know? That's why you put that music on for them and they listening it, because their little mind absorbing it. But mm-hmm. What are you teaching them to be productive in life?
Right.
You know? Right. And then you short patient with them. And like you say, it took up. Look, if we wasn't taught to take care of ourselves, to take care of the kids, how are we going to do it if mm-hmm. we not taught to certain things?
Mm-hmm.
So you got to teach. You got, and it take time and patience with a child.
Yeah. It takes time, yeah.
It take time. That's
and,
right.
And you know, I know that things have, the scope of things has changed drastically during the Bible days. Because mm-hmm. during the Bible days, mm-hmm. and I say Bible days, during those times,
mm-hmm.
because generally the man went out and worked the field or whatever he did,
mm-hmm.
and the wife stayed home with the children.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So she was really the nurturer. Teaching and instilling those values in the child. And so, but nowadays, you know, things have changed, you know, and I know I was a latchkey kid.
Mm-hmm.
And I know some of you probably know what a latchkey kid is.
That's right, that's right.
You know, put a key around that child's neck,
yeah.
And mama's working,
yeah.
And mama working two jobs, and you get home and you take that key from around you. And I remember one time I lost the key. Couldn't get in the house. And my mother said, "You better go find that key." And believe me, I retracted my footsteps. I found that key. Took me a little while, but I came home with the key.
That's right. That's right.
You know, but, you know, train up a child.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so in verse 1, Paul is given two reasons for the child to obey their parents. The first reason is because it says obey the parents in the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to, like I said, we need to include God in the picture of our training, because the child needs to understand that I'm training you, I'm trying to instill things in you because this is what I'm supposed to do, and it's, you know, it's coming from the Lord. This means that their obedience you're redirecting their obedience, that you're just not being obedient to me because I'm the parent, but you're being obedient because this is something that's pleasing to God.
That's right.
And so they learn that by being obedient to the parent, it's pleasing to God. And so then there's a second reason. It says that you may, the second reason it says, because this is right. Obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. It's the right thing to do.
That's right.
I mean,
admonition.
Sometimes they say that, I know in some cases that children get their information from other kids.
That's right.
And so it's like kids raising kids or kids teaching kids. But we need to flip the script on that. And we need to let the children know that it's right for them to learn from their parents. And, you know, and parents, don't, like I said earlier, don't be so harsh and unreasonable with your treatment of the children. Exercise a little patience.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that at times patience run a little thin, but exercise a little patience and give the child what they have need of, because remember that you're shaping this child of how this child is going to act and perform for the rest of their life, the first 1 to 5 years. More than likely, when we do the right thing, that the child is going to do the right thing.
That's right.
And then the word even says that when he gets old, he won't depart from it. So those values and those things that you instill at a young age has a way of sticking with that child. And you know, even if they walked away from it, they come back to it at some point in time in their life. So our desire is that they don't walk away from it. And so verse 1, also it talks about that's action. When you look at obey your parents and the Lord, for this is right, we're talking about something that's active. That's an action, like an action, those are action. However, we're also talking about attitude too, because later on, Paul, in one of his letters, he starts talking about fathers. Don't harass your children to the point where they become bitter.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we as fathers can, at times, we can be so scruff. I'm gonna use the word scruff with our children that they become bitter,
mm-hmm.
because we want them to perform, or we want them to measure up to a certain standard that maybe they're not there yet. And so we treat them rough, and then so now the child maybe doesn't have the self-esteem, or doesn't have the wherewithal to know that I can do it. You know, some children don't grow up not knowing that they can do it, that they're not going to accomplish anything.
That's right.
But you find a child that's getting the accolades at home,
mm-hmm.
and the confidence that you can succeed and do anything that you want. Those are some of the most successful children, those
That's
confident
right.
children.
That's right.
And so going on, it says, honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? I mean, honor your father and mother, and this is the first commandment with a promise. You know, it's something about that, because this is the first command. If you look at the Ten Commandments, this is the first commandment that actually deals with relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that God was setting something up about this, you know, because if you teach a child, the child now is going to do what you did.
Yeah.
And think about this, that a lot of times, you know, even children that say, boy, my parents were a little like this, my parents was like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then they turn out be like their parents.
That's right.
and don't want to admit it. you know, they turn out to be, you know, or to have some of the same
characteristics
or some of the same concepts that their parents had.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they got that one commercial that's out. You know, your father standing in the background. You know, are you like your parents?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Making choices and decisions like your parents, mm-hmm. even though you don't think that you do. So, what does it mean to honor your father and mother? And guess what? And you do that until you reach adulthood. You honor. I mean, you should always honor your father and mother. But what does it mean? Any words on that, Dee? To honor your father and mother?
That your life should be long, prosperous. Mm-hmm. And it's true. Not just your mother and father, but especially those. But doing back in the days, my mom used to always, you didn't say huh to a grown-up.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, ma'am, yes, sir.
Yes, uh-huh.
And, you
yes.
know, and it's miss this and miss that.
Yes.
You didn't call them by their name.
Right.
You know, and it's just a lesson I learned from a young age. Now kids, you know,
uh-huh.
But because children are raising children.
Well, they say what?
Yeah. And that was a forbidden word.
Oh, I
never had the nerve to to say those type thing right, mom. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It was just like that. I mean, and during our time, it's like to say, it take a village to raise a child. But it was just respect because I stepped out the house with a shirt, not tucked in my pants, and the lady next door called me and said, come here. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, put that shirt in. I said, yes, ma'am. You know,
yeah.
I wasn't gonna argue with her because right. she was our next door neighbor, and if she'd have went to mama and said, "I told that boy to do this and he didn't," it'd been terrible.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
But yeah, honor that mother and father.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
And you know, the honor supersedes obedience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, because you know, a child when they become an adult. Don't owe their parents. They don't have to be obedient to their parents.
Yeah.
You know, they make their own decisions.
But
they still need to honor them.
That's right.
You know, like I used to tell my son, you know, you know, as long as I'm around, you know.
I'm your father.
Yeah.
I'm your father. And you got to honor.
And you know, you carry my name.
That's right.
And so let's be respectful of that. You know, honor that. And it's something about that. I mean, even, my stepfather, Mr. Davis, and I call him, even to the day, I call him Mr. Davis,
mm-hmm.
Out of respect.
Yeah.
And he even told me, no, you can call me Neil. He wanted me to call him by his first name.
By his first name.
But I call him Mr. Davis.
You didn't feel right doing it.
Yeah.
And you know it wasn't showing the proper respect.
And, you know, my mother taught me yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, and yes, sir, and no, sir.
That's right.
And I taught that to my children, and even today, my children still says yes, sir, and no, sir, and yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, so those are the types of things that we can instill along the way. So honor simply means demonstrating high respect. And
yeah.
Think about that. It's just a high respect that I respect you. And so Paul is saying this in verse 2, first commandment with the promise. He reinforces the idea that God promises blessings on obedient children.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
So God is saying, if you're obedient, I'm going to bless you for being obedient. And that's a promise. So that's one of those things that, you know, when you say you can take that to the bank, you know, that's one of those things that you can.
Yeah.
And so let's move on down to the verse 4. And fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Paul is addressing these dads, and he makes it clear that father's authority over children does not allow him to be unreasonable.
That's right.
And, that's right. And, you know, we get beside ourselves sometimes. You know, I brought you in this world, and I take you out. And you know, some fathers say that.
Yeah, in a heartbeat.
And, And so they, and they, the children rate are, they grow up under that, that umbrella of, I don't know if that's fear, or, you know, it's unreasonable.
Yeah.
And that's really what that is, unreasonable. Demands and strictures that might drive a child to anger.
Yeah.
So we provoke a child to anger.
Yeah.
Or we keep them in a mindset where they don't want to do the right thing, or they're thinking of, and remember, to do the wrong thing is a natural occurrence.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have to spend a whole lot of time thinking to do the wrong thing. But it will just happen if we're not doing the right thing as parents.
Yeah.
Parents certainly have the opportunity to provoke their children to wrath. And guess what? We do. Because we can pick every little thing.
Pick it apart.
I mean, because guess what? Children are children.
That's right.
I mean, this is going to get broken. That's going to get messed up. You know, I mean, things are going to happen. And if we pick on every little incident that happened, that can provoke a child to anger, or put them in a place where their mind is not healthy,
and
or their attitude changes, or they may think that you're unkind. I mean, because guess what? We want to teach our children kindness and gentleness along the way too.
Yeah.
Well, guess what? If they're not being treated, if they don't feel like they're being treated kind and gentle, that's going to be hard for them to decipher and to act and to walk that out. You know, so we need to not only talk it, but we need to walk it.
Yeah.
And so, and don't be overcritical. And how they perform. And I always say, just remember how it was when we were either that age, or when we were struggling with how to overcome something or how to learn something, and what it took for us to get through or to get over that hump. And remember that the child is going through the same thing that you went through at that particular age, or maybe even before or after that particular age.
That's right.
And so so we don't want to put ourselves in a position where we're tormenting the child rather than training the child.
It's and that word admonition.
Mm-hmm.
I just checked it out. It said a gentle or friendly criticism or warning.
Oh, yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
Don't be harsh all the time.
Right.
Driving a person. You could do things in a civilized, careful, concerning manner.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought that just
them, yeah, giving them some hope.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because especially in today's society, you know, the home really needs to be a safe place,
safe haven for the child.
Yeah, and the child needs to know that they have that safe place.
That's right.
And that they can share their thoughts, or they can talk freely. And I mean, not being disrespectful, but sometimes a child maybe not don't know how to express certain things, so they need to feel that they can share this with you. But you find a child that begins to hold things in. You don't know what's going on in that child's
mind.
There's
a lot happening there.
And I mean, there's just so many different things that's taking place today.
Uh-huh.
That and then they blaming, you know, like that case that just happened.
The mother got charged for
what the child did.
That's right.
And that mass shooting.
Yeah,
and so because they're saying that you should have paid attention.
And plus, they bought the gun for the boy.
Yeah.
I mean, that's another thing. You just come on now. They're too quick to arm these kids,
mm-hmm.
and then they spend all the time by themselves.
Yeah,
you don't know what they're doing, and probably not talking to the child to find out what type of problem they have. You know,
right?
And like you said, if they don't feel safe at home, well, then where they gonna feel safe at?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they need somebody to go to, and their mother and father should be that someone.
Right, and so remember this that just talked about the admonition,
mm-hmm.
that encouragement and rebuke must be combined with training and teaching.
That's right.
So you just can't discipline the child without teaching them, you know, what's the learning objective here?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what is the outcome? You know, you can correct a child, but you need to also train them in the process so that hopefully you'll get the desired result the next time. You know, so the training, remember that. Encouragement and rebuke must be combined with training and teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And so this systematic discipline and instructions should bring about some sort of respect. And remember that we're giving a child basic fundamental foundational principles. I mean, just like we all need foundational principles. You know, what's built upon the foundation, those are the things that's going to last.
That's right.
Matter of fact, remember the parable. He said, look, that if you're going to build, if you're putting straw, the straw is going to blow away.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you remember the story about the three little pigs.
Three little pigs.
You know, only the one that had his foundation secure and built a solid brick house. Stood.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the same thing that we're doing with our children. We're building on the foundation. The foundation is the gospel of Jesus Christ, you know, the word of God. We're building on that foundation. And as we add to it, it gives the child that stability that they need that's going to help them throughout life. Okay, so we're going to move on. And so verse 5, bondservants. So now Paul moves on. He talked about wives, he talks about husbands, he talked about children.
Mm-hmm.
Now he's talking about slaves, bondservants.
Mm-hmm.
Be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, and sincerity to heart as to Christ. And it's something about that, because Paul, you know, he doesn't say slavery is bad.
Mm.
And you know, he could have denounced slavery.
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't denounce slavery. And you know, because just think about this, that whole social, economical system during that day was built on slaves were a very vital part of what was going on. And so I'm not saying that slavery is good or bad, but I'm saying that during that time, that whole system, it probably was 6 to 1 for slaves,
mm-hmm. you know,
6 slaves to 1 person,
mm-hmm.
or maybe even greater ratio.
Number, yeah.
So Paul is saying this, bondservants, and guess what? Slaves were in the Roman culture, they had no rights, and they were treated as a commodity.
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine that?
Yeah.
You a commodity. And so the Bible doesn't speak against slavery, but it speaks against the abuse of slavery.
Yeah.
You know, so this is what he's saying. He's saying, look, he's saying, bondservants, be obedient to those who are your masters. So, and then Paul is flipping the script too, because he's pointing out first, not only the bondservants be obedient to your masters, but masters, you got a responsibility too.
Mm-hmm.
And remember, Philemon, he was a runaway slave.
Yeah,
ran into Paul, changed his life. Runaway slave, ran into Paul, got his life changed, and Paul gonna send him back.
Send him back with
to
a letter.
His master.
With a letter.
Yeah, with a letter in his hand. He's carrying. But you know what? That was a bold thing, because the slave could have been killed.
Mm-hmm.
For not only did he run away, but he stole something
he
too.
He robbed him, yeah.
Before he left.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had a lot of stuff that he was facing, but went back. And so in essence, what Paul was saying was, look, not only does the bondservant need to have a perspective, but also the master need to have a perspective too.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what he's saying here. He says, as to Christ. So we put Christ in the picture. And even Paul himself, he said, I'm a slave, I'm a bondservant, but I'm a bondservant to Christ. He said, I'm not a Roman prisoner. You know, I'm not in chains for Rome. I'm in chains for Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And so Paul, even in his mind, that he considered himself something unto Christ. So the word as to Christ changes the whole entire perspective. It gives you a new outlook.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and just about in anything that we do, think about this. And anything that we do, we say as unto Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not trying to get on one of those things, well, what would Jesus do?
Mm-hmm.
But really, that if I'm doing this as unto Christ, the outcome is always going to be to please Christ.
That's right.
You know, my heart's desire should be to please Christ. You know, so ultimately, that's what your goal is to please Christ. And so it reminds us that our work should be done really because we're working for Jesus.
That's right.
and he's the one that's going to be pleased with our work.
Mm-hmm.
And then look what Paul says, verse 6, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bond service of Christ.
Mm.
And you know what that eye service is. And I mean, I used to say to my mother, I said it to myself, I never said it out loud,
uh-huh.
that I'm doing what she told me to do, but
yeah.
I said I'm sitting down on the inside, but I'm standing up on the outside.
Yeah.
You know, so that eye service, you know, so that eye service, you know, we don't want to just work with eye service, working only when the boss is looking.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we got those people even today, and you probably can identify those that when the supervisor's around or the boss is around, they're the top employee.
Yeah.
You know, they're the one that's the go-to person. But then as soon as the coast is clear, they're the slacker, the one that don't, you know, you got to help them out to do this, that, and the other. And so, or as men pleasers, those who only care about pleasing man, you know, and I think in our society at one time, I think they called them brown nosers.
Yeah.
and I don't even know where that term came from, where that slang came from, but you know, and we used it. You know, somebody trying to butter up.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah.
And you know what? We didn't think highly of that type of person.
Mm-mm.
You know, those type of people that put themselves in that position, but we need to put ourselves in a position where the things that we're doing or the service that we're providing, we're doing it as unto the Lord.
That's right.
And not unto man. And see, when we change the emphasis of that, that's what really is going to speak volumes, when we change the emphasis of that.
That's right.
So as unto the Lord means that all our work is really done unto the Lord and not unto man. Isn't that something?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I'm working to please the Lord.
That's right.
And guess what? That when you do, he's going to say, well done,
my
good and faithful servant. He's the one that's going to reward you. And so it goes on to say here, we do it with fear and trembling, not with eye service, doing the will of God from the heart. Look at that. Doing the will of God from the heart. Because sometimes, you know, the taskmaster wants you to do something that you don't want to do. And there's times where the boss or the supervisor they're going to ask you to do something you don't want to do.
Yeah, that's right.
Or, you know, or put you in a spot, you know, you raise your hand to go do X, Y, and Z, and they got you over doing A, B, and C. but guess what? But when we do it from the heart, meaning that don't do it with a bad attitude, but do it from the heart as unto the Lord. It says, with goodwill, doing service as to the Lord again and not to men, knowing that whatever, verse 8, knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he's a slave or whether he's free. And see, God is no respecter person.
That's right.
So whether you're a slave or whether you're free, you know, whether you work 8 hours and got paid this amount of money or you came in at the last minute and got paid the same amount of money, everybody else, you know, that God looks at us And he's his judgment is fair, you know, across the board. And he's not going to change his opinion. But as we continue to do it as unto the Lord, that's what gets us the reward. All right, so verse 9. Now he's talking about those masters. So he talked about the servants, the bond servants. Now he's talking about those masters. He says, masters, and you masters, do the same thing to them, giving up threatening, knowing that your own master also is in heaven, and there is no partiality with him.
Mm-hmm.
So what he's saying, look, that just because you're the master, stop threatening those people.
That's right.
I mean, and you know what? The poor guy, the slave, he's working hard as he could getting whipped.
Yeah.
You know, and guess what? Just because you're whipping him, he's not going to work harder. You know, but you're threatening him, and you're whipping him, and you're pushing him down, you know, with harsh treatment. They do this knowing that they are employees of their masters. And you know what? That when we realize that masters, and I don't know, I don't even know if I want to say supervisors or bosses, but we can, bosses,
mm-hmm.
that if you're a believer, that you submitted to Christ, you submit yourself to the Lord, that he's not treating you harsh. And, you know, I think about, and I'm not sure how Chick-fil-A work, but I know that it's supposed to be a Christian-owned organization, and so
right,
they don't work on Sundays.
That's right.
You know, but I've been in a Chick-fil-A, and it seemed like everybody that worked for Chick-fil-A enjoyed working for Chick-fil-A.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know if there's, you know, anything going on behind the scene.
Yeah.
But the appearance of it is that it's a well-run Christian organization.
That's right.
And there's a lot of Christian organizations that are well-run because of how the boss is treating the employees. And it's not like he's giving them everything that they want, but he's treating them with respect, and he's treating them with fairness.
That's right.
And if you take a survey that when you start to rate your supervisor, most people will say a good supervisor is one that's fair.
Mm-hmm.
That he didn't treat this person better than he treated that person, fair across the board. And that will go, that'll speak volumes. Matter of fact, even today, I still have friendship with people that worked for me back in 1999 and 1998.
Mm-hmm.
At Ohio State. And I think one of the individuals said that I was one of the best bosses they ever had. I mean, and I mean, I don't know about all of that, but I'll take the word for it.
Okay.
But but when you start to treat people fair across the board, that sticks. And guess what? It fosters long-term relationship. That you don't, some people you can't wait to get away from.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, or, I mean, because I've had jobs and I said, I'm never even going to talk about this job anymore. I'm putting it out of my mind.
Yeah.
I work for people that I can't wait until I don't have to work for this person again.
That's right.
And so think about that, bosses, that what are you setting the stage for?
Mm-hmm.
And most bosses have said, well, I just need to get the work done. And sometimes they say a little sugar goes a long way.
Help the situation.
Yep. But then we were called to be salt, right? So a little salt goes a long way too, but it's not necessarily caustic.
Yeah.
You know, salt don't have to be caustic. You know, salt is a preserver.
That's
right. If you look at it,
you know,
it doesn't always have to sting.
Yeah.
You know, matter of fact, you put a little salt on some bland food and it
helps it out.
That's right.
Season that joint.
Oh, yeah. So so it says, you know, give up the threatening. that harsh treatment. And then look at verse 10. It says, "And finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." Ooh, finally. So he gets to a point where he talked about all of this stuff. And now he says, "And finally," meaning, "and this too." You know, we're going to add something else. "And this too, finally." In other words, so he said, in other words, let's sum all of this up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, let's sum things up and talk about what it is that we've just already discussed. He's saying that that Paul carefully established our place in Jesus. So if you look at what he did up to this point, Paul talked about from Ephesians chapter 1 to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. He talked about who we are in Christ. He laid the foundation. And then so he said, "All right, now that you know who you are in Christ," and that's one of the things that we need to know and understand, who we are in Christ. Because when we understand who we are in Christ, that helps us to continue to stay where we are in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And then how are we going to stay there? He says, "Got to put some armor on." So that's what he's leading up to. He said, "Hey, now that you know who you are, that how are you going to stay rooted and grounded in who
Christ.
Now that you know who you are, how are you going to stay there?"
Mm-hmm.
Put this armor on. So in other words, he said, finally, he said, "Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might." So Paul is talking about how being strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. You remember the story how David strengthened himself in the Lord? You know, that they had been out fighting the battle with the enemy.
Mm.
The enemy said, "Oh no, we don't want you to fight with us." So they went back home, come to find out their family was gone.
Yeah,
all of their livestock, everything was taken.
Yeah.
And it was 600 men. And so I'll make the story short. And so they pursued the people that took their families and their livestock and their goods. A couple hundred of them couldn't make it, but the rest of them went on. But anyway, they retrieved all of their possessions. But along the way, they wanted to kill David. They blamed him. Can you imagine? They blamed him for what was taking place. I guess they said, "If we hadn't been here, this wouldn't have happened.
That's
we'd be out there with you, fighting with the enemy." So, anyway, so it says that David strengthened himself in the Lord, meaning that David got along with God. And sometimes that's what it takes for us to get along with God and allow ourselves to be strengthened in the Lord, allow God to just overshadow us, to build up our fortitude, that we can continue to do what we need to do. And so what he's saying, he's going to equip us to do exactly this, to be strengthened in the Lord in the power of his might, not our might.
Mm.
You know, nothing that I can conjure up. I can't conjure this up. I can't make it up.
That's right.
You know, it's all about him. And so now they Paul is going to point out that we are in a battle. And if we're going to learn how to maintain who we are in Christ, we need to put on some armor. We need to be ready for this battle.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's teaching them about the spiritual warfare. And so he's saying, look, he says, "Put on the whole armor of God," verse 11, "that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." Ooh. Now, it's something about, he didn't say put on part of the armor of God. He said, look, put on the whole armor of God.
The whole armor.
And it's essential for us to learn that we need to put on the whole armor of God. And nobody goes nobody should go into a situation half prepared, you know, or unprepared for what's about to come. And so Paul is pointing out that we are, he says that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. What are the wiles? What do you think the wiles are? The wiles of the devil.
Yeah, evil suggestions. And, mm-hmm. Okay.
Anything he can throw at you.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? The enemy will throw anything at you.
That's right.
And it'll come from left field and right field and center field. I mean, it's coming from everywhere. Those wiles. And guess what? It's not even just objects. Even though they don't talk about flaming darts,
mm-hmm.
those arrows. But it's thoughts too.
Yeah.
You know, the wiles of the devil. He'd be the little innuendos, the little suggestions. You know, that's the reason why we have to be on top of the game. You know, we have to be on top of our game when we're. That's the reason why we need to put this armor on. So he says that we'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And so, and I made a note here that the ancient Greek word for armor is used only one other place in the New Testament. And Jesus spoke about this in Luke. I'm going to turn over there. Luke chapter 11, verses 21 and 22. It says, chapter 11, verse 21 and 22, it says this here. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are in peace. But when a stronger than he comes upon him and overcomes him, he takes from him all his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoils.
Mm.
So that's that same armor that they're talking about. It's the same armor that Paul is talking about here, that he's fully armed. He's fully protected, you know, and guess what? When you're fully protected, you can guard your house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're fully protected, when you got this full armor of God on, you don't have to worry about nobody coming in or nothing coming in to disrupt your house.
That's right.
Or your space. And so Jesus, but when the stronger man comes. Now, who is the stronger man?
In this instant?
Yeah.
Jesus
is the stronger man.
Yeah.
And so he comes and he disarms the one that thought he was strong. and don't forget that. So when we put on the whole armor of God, you know, that there's nothing that can withstand or nothing that can guard against the whole armor of God. And then think about that when you fully clothed in the armor of God, and we didn't even get into the armor yet.
Yeah,
we're just
right.
talking about putting on the whole armor of God. We want to understand how essential it is to put the armor on. You know, because even David, remember David,
mm-hmm.
and Goliath?
Yeah.
Saul wanted to give him his armor.
Yeah.
And David said, it's too big. I haven't tested it. You know, so David didn't even want to put that armor on. But God is telling us not to be like that, but put the whole armor on. That way you can be fully protected against the wiles of the devils.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's going to break this thing down. He says this, that for we wrestle not against flesh and blood,
uh-huh.
but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. So he's saying, look, there's some serious stuff going on out here. And guess what? It's stuff that you can see, and it's stuff that you can't see.
That's right.
And so we wrestle not against flesh and blood. But against principalities, against powers, against rulers of of the darkness of this age.
Mm-hmm.
That's something. Think about that. That the battle that we're in, that really the only way that we can be fully equipped to fight this battle
mm-hmm.
is to put that armor on.
That's right.
Otherwise, we're going into a situation that is a no-win situation.
That's right.
If we don't put on the armor of God, it's a no-win situation.
And like you said, the full armor of God.
The full armor. and don't forget, as we go into the armor, we're going to stop here. And next week, we're going to pick up going into the armor.
Mm-hmm.
But I want you to think about this week until next week and do some searching on for yourself. Meditate on this, you know, about putting on that whole armor of God, being fully prepared to fight this battle. You know what? You can put the armor on and not do anything and you're protected.
You're protected.
I like being in the tank.
Yeah.
You know, they got stuff they can take in. But you put the armor on. But now we're going to be able to show what the armor is, talk about what the armor is, so that we'll understand the things that are at our disposal.
That's right.
All right?
That's
so that's where we're going to stop. We're going to stop there. And we're going to pick this up next week. I pray that all our minds are clear.
Yes.
We talked a lot about children and the responsibility of parents to train their children.
Yes.
Give them something that's going to help them be successful in this world, this life. And just remember where we were.
Yes.
When we were coming up. You know, I mean, I know I was a blockhead. and I thank God my mother had patience with me.
Yes.
And I remember the day I came home and I told her that I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior.
Mm.
She couldn't do nothing but let tears flow out of her eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that was like music to her ears.
That's right.
And it happened later on in life, but it happened to where she can still reap some benefit from her teaching and her training.
Yes.
Father God, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
Allah, I pray, Lord, that as your word goes forth, that it will do what you sent it forth to do, that it will not return to you void. So, Lord, continue to touch our hearts and our minds, Lord. Continue to energize us, Lord, to do the right thing and to be right. And, Lord, and help us, Lord, to not despise the good things of God.
That's right.
Because you've given us so many good things, Lord, and sometimes we just take it for granted. But, Lord, right now, Lord,
right
we
now.
Just thank you so thank much you. For all that you've done, all that you declared that you would do. Lord, we're going to continue to pray for those who need prayer, Lord, that you would touch them in a special way. Allow them to experience you, Lord, that will just blow their minds, God. Lord, that they themselves will be revived and encouraged, Lord, knowing that their Father cares for them and
yes.
He loves them.
Yes.
He's nurturing them, giving them what they have need of.
Yes.
And we thank you so much,
thank
Lord,
you.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.